you all to BCC's first National Women's Day, and happy National Women's Day to you all, men and women alike. I guess I should keep that over here. Okay, International Women's Day has been observed since the early 1900s, beginning at a time of great expansion and turbulence in the industrialized world that also saw booming population growth and a rise in new and different ideologies. International Women's Day is a collective day of global celebration and a call for gender parity. No one government, charity, corporation, academic institution, women's network, or media hub is solely responsible for International Women's Day. The story of struggle for equality belongs to no single feminist nor to any one organization, but to the collective efforts of all who care about human rights, says world-renowned feminist, journalist, and social and political activist Gloria Steinem. Thus, International Women's Day is all about unity, celebration, reflection, advocacy, and action, whatever that looks like globally at a local level. In the early 1900s, great unrest and critical debate was occurring amongst women regarding equality and equity. Women's oppression and inequality was spurring women to become more vocal and active in campaigning for change. Then in 1908, 1,500 women marched through New York City demanding shorter hours for better pay and voting rights. In 1909, in accordance with the declaration by the Socialist Party of America, the first National Women's Day conference was observed across the United States on February 22nd. Women continued to celebrate National Women's Day on the last Sunday of February until 1913. In 1911, following a decision at Copenhagen's meeting, International Women's Day was honored for the first time in Austria, Denmark, Germany, and Switzerland. Sadly, on March 25, 1911, here in the United States, a fire spread through the cramped Triangle Waste Company garment factory on the 8th, 9th, and 10th floors of the Ash Building in Lower Manhattan. Workers in the factory, many of whom were young women recently arrived from Europe, had little time or opportunity to escape. The rapid spreading of the fire killed 146 women workers. The building has only one fire escape, which collapsed during the rescue efforts. Long tables and bulky machinery trapped many of the victims. Panicked workers were crushed as they struggled with doors that were locked by managers to prevent theft, or doors that opened in the wrong direction. Only a few buckets of water were on hand to douse the flames. Outside, firefighters' ladders were too short to reach the top floors and ineffective against as safety nets ripped like paper. This disastrous event drew significant attention to working conditions and labor legislation in the United States that became a focus of subsequent International Women's Day events. On the eve of World War I, campaigning for peace, Russian women observed their first International Day on the last Sunday of February in 1913. As I stated earlier, in 1913, following discussion, International Women's Day was transferred to 8th of March, and this day has remained globally. The day was finally recognized by the United Nations in 1975. In the early millennium, International Day activities around the world had stalled in many countries. The world had moved on, and feminism wasn't a popular topic. International Women's Day needed reignition. There was urgent work to do. Battles had not been won, and gender parity still had not been achieved. Oops, what happened? In 2011, we celebrated the 100th centenary of International Women's Day. In the United States, Barack Obama proclaimed March 2011 to be Women's History Month, calling Americans to mark International Women's Day by reflecting on, quote, the extraordinary accomplishments of women, end quote, in shaping the country's life, the country's history, excuse me. Where are we now? The original aim to achieve full gender equality for women around the world still has not been realized. A gender gap persists beyond the globe, and women are still not represented in equal numbers in business or politics. Figures show that globally, women's education, health, and violence towards women is still that worse than that of men. Goals set by the United Nations International Women's Day to be achieved by 2030 included ensuring that all girls and boys complete free, equitable, and quality primary and secondary education, an end to all forms of discrimination against all women and girls everywhere, elimination of all forms of violence against all women and girls in the public and private spheres, including trafficking and sexual and other types of exploitation. International Women's Day continues to be a time to reflect on progress made, to call for change, and to celebrate acts of courage and determination by ordinary women who have played an extraordinary role in the history of their countries and communities. The theme for this year's International Women's Day is #BeBoldForChange. Though the world has witnessed a significant change and attitudinal shift in both women's societies and thoughts, women's equality and emancipation, and although many from a younger generation feel that all the battles have been won, many feminists believe only too well that the longevity and ingrained complexity of patriarchy exist still. In support of these continued inequalities, International Women's Day calls for a day without a woman. Today, as we honor Women's Day, we are proud to present three incredible Bristol Community College women who will talk about their experiences at women's marches in both Boston and in Washington. These marches gathered significant momentum the day after the inauguration of the current president, a president whose political campaign promises to bring women right back to 100 years ago. It's my pleasure to introduce Associate Professor of Sociology, Colleen Avedikian, Research Librarian for the Fall River Campus, Emily Brown, and Research Librarian for New Bedford Campus, Souza-Mort. Excuse me, Susan. We could have a warm round of applause for them.
We'd like to see if anybody here has marched in any of the local marches, whether in DC or Providence. If you could just please stand up so we can recognize and honor you as well.
Washington, D.C. A couple days after the election, I was really stunned by a number of things. And one was that the way that I live my life, the way that I view the world, was so out of touch with a number of my fellow citizens. That was really jarring to me. But I also had a sense of, what can be done about this? You know, how do we change a path that I think that the country is heading down? And I thought gathering with folks that were interested in solving issues, coming together as coalitions, building relationships, that was really important. And it was actually my actual plans to get to DC were spurred by an old friend of mine who called on the phone. She lives in a red state, and she was very depressed. And she said, We should go. She said, I don't know what we're going to do, but we should just be in Washington the weekend of the inauguration. And so it was very early on, even before the plans were set for the Women's March. It's November 12th. We had our tickets. And we didn't know what was going to happen, but we knew that something was going to happen, and we book that flight and a hotel room to be in DC, we were shocked, shocked at the number of people that showed up. I know that Emily also was in DC as well. I'll let her speak about it. But one of the, as the plans began to take shape for the Women's March, what really attracted me was the message of intersectionality of this march. For so long, even teachers, we look at problems, but we often define problems through our experiences or the way that we experience the world. And we don't think about the ways in which social problems are experienced and how they are viewed by a number of different folks. So intersectionality is this recognition, really, that oppression and injustice happens on multiple levels. Right? So it's not just about race, it's not just about gender, it's about ableism, it's about heterosexism, it's about classism. And the march itself, for the very first time in my lifetime, organized people for a variety of different topics. So it wasn't there wasn't one simple reason why people came to DC. There were groups advocating for a number of different issues, but what was shared was this idea that we have to stick together. No one group is going to maybe make the change that needs to happen. We all have to stick together. And so this march was not just about women. It was about ending violence, reproductive rights, LGBTQIA rights, workers' rights, civil rights, disability rights, immigrant rights, and also environmental justice. And it was really powerful to be standing in groups of people and dialoguing with them, talking to them about their view of the issues and what needed to be done to bring about change. And so those are just some of the initial thoughts I had about the DC March. I'm going to pass this along to Emily, who also was with me, but I didn't see her.
A lot of pink hats. I kept looking in the background of my pictures, like seeing if I could see like a glimpse of Colleen as she walked through the crowd. I feel like my road to Washington was pretty long. So if you'll permit me, I'm just going to tell you a brief story. So I've marched for women in the past, and I've marched for women in Washington, D.C. But this time I marched because I felt our politics were broken. In 2006, I moved to a red state. I moved to Oklahoma. I was raised in liberal Massachusetts. I lived in New York State. I lived in Pennsylvania. I understood red state politics from afar, but then I moved there, right? And before I kind of tell you about what it's like to live in a red state, I want you guys to understand I love Oklahoma and I love my Oklahoma friends, but their politics are problematic. So as I moved down there, I started to realize that our elected representatives had notions that I tended to disagree with. For instance, there is a senator, you guys may recognize his name, Jim Inhofe, who argued that climate change didn't exist because there was snow and he could make a snowball, and I'm not kidding, you can Google this. He also claimed that humans couldn't manipulate the planet or climate because the Bible said so. And so this was what I was introduced to as I moved to Oklahoma. There were ballot initiatives banning Sharia law, which passed, which, in my opinion, was silly. I think I remember standing there at the ballot going, what? Like reading the ballot banning Sharia law. I had students at the time who would share stories about being intimidated at the polls, that they would go to the polls and that people would discourage them from voting verbally and physically. And coming from a northern state, that was hard for me to identify with, but the longer I was there, the more I believed it. I saw swastikas on Obama signs. I saw all sorts of things that, coming from a northern, relatively liberal state, were just totally new to me. In 2012, Oklahoma introduced legislation to enact personhood. How many of you guys know what personhood is? Personhood is essentially human life begins at inception. So the minute an egg is fertilized, that is a person. This is problematic on a lot of levels. One of the things that drives me crazy and drives me to women's marches is the topic of abortion, because abortion is not a black and white issue, right? If you have an ectopic pregnancy, a pregnancy in your fallopian tubes, you need to have an abortion. If your pregnancy is not viable, it could kill the mother, you need to have an abortion. This is something that is a complex, nuanced, and complicated conversation that women have with their doctors, right? And so they introduced personhood, and at 8.5 months pregnant, I marched on the capital of Oklahoma City to protest personhood. I did. I was super pregnant too. So what I like to say is that I'm not pro-abortion, but I am pro-choice. That we can't have laws that trap women into certain things because of how we might feel about it. So I've marched because I've seen this before. The deep red state politics now seem like there are national politics. This is no longer just about women. We need to come together to speak out against a fringe politics that doesn't fully represent America or American citizens.
So why I marched? Interesting. I've never ever been felt so that I want to be a political activist. I never woke up in the morning and said, I want to be this way. I've never marched in anything before. I am 47 years old. I have lived a life under other Republican presidents. I am unenrolled. I vote wherever I feel is the best candidate. To me, as you said, I woke up in this surreal this morning, you know, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe. We just elected a reality television star who is a millionaire who's never known what it's like to, you know, live paycheck to paycheck, or maybe you can't go to the doctor because I don't have the health insurance, or I can't even do the copay. Like, he's never had that. And even more importantly was how it affected my son. My son is 16, and he actually was so funny. I was getting ready to do the women's march. I had my sign out on the table, and he said, Mom, I want to march. He's like, I feel important that I march with you. And I was like, all right. And he sat up, he made his sign. I was very proud of him. He actually is now, he wants to run into politics. He's actually gonna be running to be a delegate of our town. And he's only 16. He's already thinking ahead where he wants to get involved. We've already got some Democratic national committees that we're going to this whole month lined up. So I mean, we have more power, especially for younger people, which is what we really need to get involved in politics. I know when I was 16, that was the least furthest thing from my mind, is thinking about politics. So I gathered with a bunch of my friends, and we decided to go to Boston. I wanted to go to DC, but I wasn't paying $1,000 a day for a room at that point. So I went with about 20 of my friends, and it was really this cohesiveness, and it was really interesting just going to the train in Wareham. Middleborough, just to go to the Boston Common. There was already women lined up, people wearing their hats. Getting to there and just marching to Boston Common, there was this sense of solidarity and being unified under many different causes. There were many different groups there. There were religious groups, there were Muslim groups, there were LGBTQ groups, there were feminist groups, reproductive rights groups. So as Colleen had pointed out, we all came under different, you know, we identified with different topics. I just wanted to make sure that we all had rights. Because, you know, let's face it, I'm white, I make an okay paycheck, I have health insurance. None of this stuff is going to affect me. But it's going to affect my students, my colleagues, my peers. And if we stop feeling empathy, then where does that leave us as a nation? Like, we, you know, I mean, I came as immigrants, my family emigrated here. So a lot of the issues that are going on with this new presidency just baffles me as Americans. I mean, I don't know even know where to begin. Oh wait, and there is one quote I wanted to read that I actually have this on my bulletin board in my New Bedford campus. And it's by Marion Wright Edelman. And she says, "You just need to be a flea against injustice. Enough committed fleas biting strategically can make even the biggest dog uncomfortable and transform even the biggest nation." So by having all these women's marches and having these days and all these protests, and I feel like if we have enough of our fleas, that we can make a difference. And I hope we can see, maybe get a BCC bus going to the science march that will be happening on Earth Day to, you know, science is real. Facts matter.
Okay, we'd like to open it up to the audience now. If you have any questions, just raise your hand and we'll get the mic to you. No questions? Go ahead.
So my question is for Colleen or Emily. I went to the Women's March in Boston, and there was peaceful marches all over the country, which was great. I was so proud of so many people marching and there being peace, but I know there was some instance in Washington, D.C., and I was kind of tracking you on Facebook, stalking you, making sure you were okay. Were you close by any of those violent incidents, or did you see any of that go down?
So there were some violent protests on the day of the inauguration. As far as I'm aware, it was nothing but a peaceful march in Washington when I was there. The only disturbance I saw was that there was a small group of pro-life people who had set up a graphic sign, and then there were some feminists yelling at them. But that was the only, and I wouldn't even call that anything more than like an exchange. But as far as the protests on the day of the inauguration, I was not close to it.
I didn't see any counter-protesting. I mean, there were times after the event broke up, and it, to call it a march, if you've watched the right, but it wasn't really a march. Right, it was kind of a movement toward it. Even the organizers were really taken back by the number of people who showed up. But after things began to break down, and then in the next day, I went to a number of the Smithsonian museums, and there were some passive-aggressive shade thrown, and there was just no engaging of it. There were people who were there for the inauguration that had very specific ideas about the color pink and politics, and we just didn't engage. But what was powerful is to look around, and within the perimeter, I think that had there been a confrontation, there would have been, you know, people would have been drawn in very quickly. I felt very safe being in D.C. I didn't have any fear once I got there. I had some fear before, watching what happened the day before. I had no fear once I got there.
I have to, like, say that when we were getting emails about what to do if you get pepper spray, like, I was getting scared, and I thought, should I even bring my kid? Like, I had my friend bringing her newborn. Hopefully you've seen her picture. She's adorable. But honestly, when we got there, I don't think, number one, there was any one violent incident in any of these protests across the nation. I looked for statistics. I couldn't find any. And I know when you were in Boston, it was just a really empowering, I mean, like I said, my friend was breastfeeding her daughter, and women, like, made a little shield wall around her.
There she is.
As we marched, right, yeah. And so I just feel like when you get all these women together and men, and there was a lot of people brought their children, it was a pretty safe environment.
Yeah, just to add to that, the subway was very, very crowded, and there was a woman who passed out on the subway. And just, it was like a network of tell the next person, but there was the protective shield where strangers were trying, because you can imagine people trying to get out and in, and what kind of chaos that is. And that woman was protected until we could get her medical care. It was really quite amazing.
I just want to agree with what Susan said. My son is 4 years old, and I had considered bringing him. I decided against it for safety reasons, and also an 11-hour car trip, you know what I'm saying. So when we got there, the feeling was so positive. You know, that you can expect some political movements to have anger against, like, the current, you know, iteration of power. But at the same time, that's not what this was about. It was very positive. Everybody was, you know, there for the same reason, and there was a connectedness, I think, between everybody.
I will say that people did challenge each other. that different groups would challenge each other about being more inclusive. And so when I first came off the subway, there were a group of Black feminists ready to talk and challenge people about how white feminism has not been very inclusive. It's been classist as well. And so there were dialogues that happened, but even within groups that may not have understood each other, it didn't get to the level that there was hostility within groups.
Yeah, and I can say next to us, we tried to distance ourselves, was an anarchist group. So yeah, there was that.
They get the best signs.
Yeah.
I don't need more. I'll just be loud. A lot of these people have to listen to me every day at this time. I'm wondering if you felt like people who were on different sides of a certain topic were still able to come together over other things. So for example, Emily mentioned that there was a pro-life group who had graphic signs or whatever, and then there was a group of feminists yelling at them. But I'm curious about, that's not my main point, I'm curious about if you felt that people who perhaps differed on the idea of, say, reproductive rights in this setting still came together over other issues for women, such as equal pay, equal rights, etc.
Well, I was gonna say, I know for a fact that there was a lot of church groups there, and they were very supportive, and I think that's just key. You know, I saw a lot of churches there with signs marching, and I actually read a few Christian blogs of why, and that, you know, again, everyone marched for different reasons, but we all believed in solidarity that this current administration was being very exclusive to not just one group, but to many, many different groups.
If I may just add, one of the things that we've all said is that we all marched for different reasons. You know, some of them overlap, some of them don't. Some of us, you know, we marched with reproductive rights in mind or not, right? So I feel like you showed up because you cared about some aspect of what was being talked about then. You know, there were Black Lives Matter signs, there were immigrant chants, you know, no wall, no ban, no wall, you know, was a big one. So it's like, if that was your, you know, reason for showing up, you were there because you're in this, it was almost like an agreement in opposition, but, you know, for different aspects of the opposition.
And I just want to say that when I got to DC, there was no line where we checked in and said, this is my issue. And there were a number of times that more conservative friends had challenged me about what they thought were women, pro-life women being kicked out of the march, or pro-life groups. And there was no way to tell unless you carried a sign or you started a chant or you had some kind of, you know, insignia, what your issue was. And so my response was, I can't imagine that anybody was plucked out of that march for any particular reason, because the overarching march, the theme was that we need to be together on this. And, you know, that's I think the most important takeaway from this is the way that we form coalitions and we collaborate. We don't always agree within coalitions, right, on every issue, but there are some things that we have to agree to some core principles. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, absolutely. I encourage you to visit the Women's March main website. There have been huddle ups, which local people have been inviting participants into their homes to talk about the next steps. This is one of them. The this I keep forgetting what the it's like the state, I keep wanting to say stay at home, which is a stay, woman, day without a woman. But if you go to their website, there is definitely a clear agenda. And I know for my next agenda, I've also been to a couple of huddle-ups in my town, but I also plan on marching with the scientists again in Boston on Earth Day.
I plan on marching with the science group as well. Another thing that I've been reading a lot of is that there have been a remarkable number of women who have decided to run for office in their local municipalities, which is an amazing front to see because we need representation. I mean, if we thought, you know, during the 2008 and 2012 elections that we were, our profile was being raised, we still had minimal representation in Congress, right, and in the Senate. And so having women run in their local precincts, in their local districts, can really only help to represent what we want on a local level.
And I believe Michael Moore also put together a protest calendar, which if you go to the protest calendar, there's actually been not a lot of them covered by the media, but almost every weekend, someone is protesting something. So that's another way to get involved.
So I actually put together that slide with the chants, and I did edit for language. But that was my favorite one. We will not go away. Welcome to your first day. And that was very specifically targeted the closer the group got to the White House. And why that was my favorite chant is, having been involved in a number of different groups over the years where you can organize a rally, okay, and that's great, and there's energy, and then what happens the next day? And so there was a commitment to people that this has to be a sustained, if we want change, it has to be sustained. And since Susan mentioned Michael Moore, regardless of different opinions about Michael Moore, he did give, you know, here's steps that you must do now. And he had the crowd chant and repeat over and over the phone number to Congress. And he said, before you know, your daily routine must be, you get up, you brush your teeth, you dial this number, and you call your representative, you call your senator, and you let them know. What he was trying to do is get people involved back in democracy, even at every level. So certainly running for office is important, but even letting your representative know what the issues are. We often, I'm part of an organization called PHENOM, the Public Higher Education Network of Massachusetts, and shout out there, Travis, and Amy and Ron. And we try to get people to meet with their representatives. Well, this year we had Advocacy Day, our sixth annual Advocacy Day. It's never been easier to organize people to get to a place over issues related to injustice in education. Sometimes you have to kind of reinvent the wheel. You have to, you know, explain what it is that you're doing. We had a room that was so packed that the acoustic at the State House, that we couldn't even hear all the people in the back. Many people missed the fabulous speech given by our own Amy Blanchett. But this idea of doing these things to keep sustaining is so key that we can't lose the momentum of the march.
You know, I think a conversation that we need to have is making sure and holding our elected officials accountable.
Yes.
We see mass protests and town hall meetings that are being dismissed across this country. And as a former red state resident, I've called my representatives and had my views ignored. You know, it's very difficult to live in a place that doesn't reflect your, you know, a true community's feelings and you know, actions. So we have to be able to hold them accountable, and we have to vote. We have to show up, and we have to vote, and we have to vote in midterm elections, not just the presidential years, because this is how people stay in office.
Remember, they work for you.
They do. Involved or how to advocate?
Well, yeah. Did you find out what was some of the, what I would do is maybe set up a poll or try to talk to, what was the barrier? Was it transportation? Was it, you know, work schedules, that sort of thing, because that can be inhibiting. I know a lot of, I work in the New Bedford campus, and I know with my students down there, a lot of them don't have their own vehicles. So that's right there. That's hard for them to get anywhere. So that's a key point.
But even like other little things that we can do just in the community itself, just to get girls involved.
So on March 20th at 4 o'clock?
Is it 4? What time is brunch?
At 4 o'clock, 4:30, and this is for everyone. This is a public service announcement. At 4:30, Senator Michael Broderick is going to be meeting a group of constituents from the area to talk about the issues that impact them, and specifically we're going to be looking at some legislation impacting public education, but you could invite the students to come in, especially if they've never talked to a legislator before. They're not always scary up close, this might be small steps, and then the next step can be, well, maybe we can organize and invite a state representative to come to our school and speak to us. Maybe those small kinds of steps.
Is that legislator speaking here at BCC?
Yes, and I'm sorry, thank you. It's going to be in the G building in the faculty staff lounge at 4:30 on the 20th of March.
Is that registration or is there anyone who can come?
I'm making a... I didn't ask permission, so anybody can
ask forgiveness.
I mean, I'll ask for forgiveness. Anyone can.
Thank you.
I just have a comment. Just so people are aware, in G building they have the paperwork to register to vote, and you can all. So register to vote by just Googling register to vote in MA, and it's the first link. And all you need to register to vote online is a license or an ID from the NIV. So just so you guys are aware of that.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Travis.
So I have the sort of opposite problem. I do have certainly some students that are just tuning it all out, but then I also have students that are frustrated. I had one student this semester who participated in the March in Washington, and she is that same sort of frustration of what else can we do, like what do we do next, of keeping that momentum going.
Hearing you speak, that maybe we need to start something here at Bristol Community College for people who are interested, that are frustrated. I mean, like I said, I wanted to do more, so I went to the Women's March webpage and I found that there were huddles around me. There was a bunch of them in New Bedford, Dartmouth, Westport, Mattapoisett. So I went to there and met with like-minded folks. I also getting more involved with my Democratic national committees in my town. That's something important, grassroots. But maybe that's something we could have a conversation about where moving forward we maybe have a meeting of people interested on the different campuses and be a collective voice that way too.
There's an expectation that opposition will die down, right? That we'll get used to the status quo, that there will be an acceptance. And if you believe that what is going on right now is wrong, you have to stay involved. Whatever it is, there's another group that you can find on, I know they're on Twitter, that's called Indivisible, and they hold lots of...
I told the student about that.
Right. And, honestly, and I hate to keep referring to red state politics, but it's like I know what it's like to feel like you are a lost soul in a land that doesn't understand you. So it's like you just have to keep calling and keep making sure that your voice is heard and be vocal and be visible.
Yeah, I just wanted to say, I think a group on campus would be good. This particular student has tried to gather together just on her own.
We'll talk.
And get far.
Tell us her name, or tell her our name.
I really liked your recommendation to call your representatives and senators. I did just that. And I will tell you, I was really impressed with the response that I had. I received almost immediately a communication from Senator Kennedy's office, 2 pages, pointing me to different bills that are being filed, how I could support them, who to call, and who else. The other thing that I thought he said at the end of the letter that I resonates with me, it reminds me of his senator Kennedy, Ted Kennedy, was don't be afraid to cross the aisle and have the conversation with the person who disagrees with you so you can engage in dialogue about what's important. But I really, really encourage you to do that. It's been frustrating to me. I tried to get in touch with Paul Ryan, but that was something. And I quickly was told I wasn't a constituent from the state, which shouldn't matter. Right?
I called Jason Chaffetz.
But I really encourage people to do that because they are not intimidating people. They are people that just want to listen to the voters and do what we're asking. And they appreciated the support. That was the universal response I got from my reps.
I absolutely agree. One of the more positive experiences, so I called Jason Chaffetz, who had introduced a bill to get rid of or to sell off public lands from national parks. And as someone who I consider myself an environmentalist, this was extremely worrying. So I called Jason Chaffetz's office and got much of the same response, like, well, you don't live here. And I'm like, but I like national parks, so. So, you know, I called him, and I've gotten over the embarrassment of picking up the phone, right? It doesn't bother me at all. I had a really great experience of calling Elizabeth Warren's office to oppose Scott Pruitt. You know, so again, talking about Oklahoma and the amount of earthquakes that are going on right there because of fracking and natural gas drilling and this disregard for the environment that's really concerning, and now this person's in charge of the EPA. So I called Elizabeth Warren and I played my Okie card. And I said, so, fellow Okie, because you guys know she's from there, right?
Yeah.
She's a born and bred Oklahoman. And so I said, you know, I just want to draw attention to the fact that she knows where this is going and she has to fight against it. And the person's aide who answered the phone laughed and said, don't you worry, she's going to fight it. So you just know how that ended.
I just want to highlight something that you said. With Phenom and a number of different organizations, we always wonder how effective, what's the most effective way to connect with our legislators. And I know that online petitions are, you know, easy to do and people do them, or signing petitions. It is actually a phone call. Is that if you cannot meet with them in person, a phone call. They log the number of phone calls per day. And that, so call-in days, organizing a call-in day around a particular issue is way more effective than just doing one of those online petitions that you send along. So we do have to maybe be strategic about how we interact with our representatives.
And just remember, they can't see you, so like, don't be embarrassed. Just call them. It does not matter. You know, sometimes different organizations will give you a script. You know, if you feel nervous about what you're going to say, go off, read the script, that's fine. I'm sure they've heard it. But make sure that you tell them that you live at this place in their district and that you are concerned about a topic. Absolutely.
Any other questions or comments?
Hey, folks. Most of you, if not all of you, know that we've been conducting the Pizza in Politics series on campus here this semester between my office and the Office of Student Life with Kathy Burns. And I got approached about a week ago about could the next one be on this women's movement. Unfortunately, we already had the next one planned, which was yesterday, and that topic had already been selected. But I do want to announce today that our next one will be on the women's movement. I was first approached by Rob Delalue from the Multicultural Student Center about that, and so I did speak to him yesterday and gave him the news that the few of us who planned these had decided that that's what we would do the next one on. We still don't have the date and time because we keep moving them around, but it will be the week after spring break, so look for the messages and the postings and the email and all of that for further information.
Thank you.
We'll be working with some of you folks to actually organize.
I'd love to see these go to other campuses for real. Like, when that first came out, I was so excited, but I'm stuck in New Bedford. I know people are stuck in Attleboro and Taunton, so maybe moving forward.
Let me give folks a little background on that too. When we first started them, we planned to do them at all the campuses. And then when we held the first one in Fall River, we realized that in order to really, really make it a good, energizing, and worthwhile experience, you have to have a critical mass of students. So I contacted the deans at those locations, and it was decided that they couldn't guarantee that they would get that critical mass. So instead, we would use Facebook Live to have the other campuses participate. And I understand yesterday that there were some problems with the technology getting that to work properly, but ultimately it did, and we're hoping to straighten out those problems so next time around people can't participate. And I will tell you that both Attleboro and Taunton students wrote in a number of comments through Facebook Live yesterday during the live presentation.
That's fantastic.
Saturday Night Live has gotten a lot more funny.
You know, I have to say that the visibility of what we've been doing and what we've been a part of has been huge. You know, it's like you can't ignore us. We are there and we are going to make our voices heard. So I do think that there is a level of undeniability about the power of the movement right now.
You know, honestly, legislative-wise, we are really at a disadvantage. I was sick with the flu and watched C-SPAN, and everything, we're just outnumbered, Democrats in the House of Republicans. There's nothing we can do until we get to the 2018 midterm elections. But, you know, honestly, I really feel with this president, he is really about his popularity. And I think the more he sees the protests, the more it really gets him angry. I mean, because he really wants people to love him. Like, this guy comes off a reality show, you know? And I follow him on Twitter, and when all these protests comes up, it makes him angry. And I'm like, good, good. Because the more we can keep protesting, the more we can vote out these elected officials that are not listening to our voices, that's when it makes it real.
Well, you know, my main cause lately has been gerrymandering. How many of you guys have heard of gerrymandering? One of the things that we have to realize is that our votes don't always count like we think we do, you know, like we think they should. We live in a country of a representative democracy, but districts are drawn, and in many swing states were drawn in order to minimize the impact of a Democratic vote. So when I showed up to a feminist march with a political sign, I don't know if you guys saw it, but it's got a swear word on it. But one of the things I want to make sure that you guys understand is that sometimes politics is less than crystal clear. There's a lot going on a lot of different levels around this country, and you want to make sure that you know what's going on in your state and that you're active. This was the book that I read as I was driving to the march, and I based my sign on it. When I tweeted, the author wrote me back. It was really one of the most exciting things. But it's a book that opened my eyes. You know, it's like I've heard of gerrymandering on a, you know, nominal level, but then to understand how much politics and our representation can be manipulated is something that's really eye-opening. So this book, if you're at all interested and want to get angry, it's available at the Fall River Library. You guys can come over and check it out.
But just to get back to your question, I have been noticing, and this is just anecdotal, I haven't looked at it, you know, as a case study, right? But in some of the media outlets that had been more partisan, I am seeing that people are breaking ranks. Even, so MSNBC is often, you know, kind of just, oh, it's that left-wing group, but the morning show has not been. And there's Joe and Mika, I don't watch it.
Joe Scarborough.
Scarborough, they are right now absolutely, you know, calling out the president in a way that there is no pretense now of their positions. So they're making a stand, they're making claims, and they're making positions. You've even seen it with a couple of the Fox News anchors. And so do we see change in the media? You know, are these, is this a harbinger of things to come? But I think that as a response to the outcry over alternate facts and attacks on the media, I do see now that people are beginning to defend media. I did read that readership of the Washington Post, New York Times, that those are going back up. So maybe one of the the unintended consequences has been that people are moving back toward a reading for their information rather than, social media or Facebook. Yeah, that they're actually going back and reading content in a way that we had seen before.
And, it's more than just media breaking ranks. You see Lindsey Graham and John McCain and other, seasoned Republicans who have, maybe not broken ranks, but air concerns.
Yes.
Any other questions?
Stand up for this one.
Okay, so I'm hearing about how people want to get involved. If you want to get involved, the first step, you're just going to take that first step. You're going to outlet that you want to get involved in. I'm involved in a few different things, Phenom obviously being one of them. I actually started a huddle, and it was Saturday at Bristol Community College and Library of Fall River. I didn't stay long, not many people showed up. So if anyone here is interested and wants to get involved, or you know students, send them my way, because I am a pretty busy person, and if I take these things on, it's nice to have more people with you, because it's hard to do things by yourself. So if you know people who want to be involved, please send them my way. I'm also involved in agencies like Narrow Pro Choice. I'm a member, I attend their events. I donate to them, not a ton of money because I'm not rich, but that's another really great way to reach out and help the organizations. And I mean, BCC, us being students here, this is such a great outlet. There's so many opportunities for you to be able to create events to get involved. I'll be doing the clothesline project again this year with my club, BCC Coalition Against Domestic Violence, if you want to help me set that up somehow, if you want to help me recruit people to make t-shirts, I'm all about it.
What's your name?
Well, if you don't know me by now. My name is Amy Blanchett. I work in the Office of Civic Engagement and peer advising, and I work for Phenom, and you'll find me somewhere around here. And if you don't know where to find me, ask someone, they'll tell you.
Amy, what's a huddle?
A huddle?
You said you
have a my huddle is called Let's Huddle for Education, Inclusion, and Humanity. So basically everything. It's a small group of people. And I also belong to a group on Facebook, which is a really awesome group. It's called Action Together Southeastern Massachusetts. So people post all kinds of actions events that are happening all over Southeastern Massachusetts. It's a great outlet. They post town hall meetings with the legislators. They post rallies, Narrow Pro-Choice events. All kinds of things that are going on. So that's another group I highly suggest that you join if you're interested in getting involved and wanting to make a difference. But a huddle is a small group of individuals who are looking to fight these social justice issues head on, to take these next steps from the rally that we attended. So the packet that they gave me has, these bills are trying to want to get passed through legislation. So this is what we need to do. We need to organize a call-in session to call your legislators, or send out emails, petitions, or whatever it may be. So if you're interested, please get in touch with me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Maybe I don't need that. Can I make one more comment? I'd like to repeat a quote that I heard during the election that I think is very appropriate here. And I say it coming from the most, I belong to the most privileged class in this country, white males. And I say this quote because as I think this movement has to continue, because there's going to be resistance, there's going to be pushback, and tremendous amount of it. And And the reason being, I don't know who said this, but I heard it during the election, when you've lived a life of privilege, equality can seem like oppression. And I can see that's what will happen with this movement as people try to push back and push back. So make sure you keep it going.
Sometimes,
make sure we keep it going.
Right.
Rephrase that.
And sometimes the degree of pushback is also an indication that the long run we're winning.
Mm.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry.
The pushback, the degree of pushback sometimes means that we are actually winning, that we're making
strides,
yeah, progress.
I can probably be heard without that, but
okay.
I have a very loud voice. On the other side of, I've got at least one student so concerned about being involved, as well as some others. I was talking to another faculty member in my area yesterday, which we have a pretty tight area, because I teach in the arts. There is at least one student who has been feeling very displaced because her views are outside of this. And so he was worrying about how to help support her, but she is getting like really alienated from everyone else. So that is that other side of not just, you know, reaching across to people, because when I heard that and I think that, I think of people my age that are, you know, stuck in their ideas versus someone who is 18 years old who has got one foot in an art program, which is pretty diverse and vocal and all that, and one foot back in a very conservative upbringing and is struggling in between the two. So I just wanted to bring that up too.
Thank you.
I got a question. Some scholars, men's rights movement is a part of the movement. There's been backlash from feminists.
Some scholars consider that men's rights movement is a part of a movement that's been backlash from feminists.
How many of you guys are familiar with men's rights? Okay. So my understanding, and I might be, I hope to represent what they think correctly, but the men's rights movement, as far as I can tell, now feels that because of feminism, that men no longer matter. And that men need to be able to band together in order to then be equal to the feminists. Is your question, do we agree? Can you rephrase your question, or just remind me again?
Some scholars consider that men's rights movements, or parts of the movements, may have backlash to feminism. Men's rights activists contest claims by feminists that men have greater power, privilege, or advantage than women, and many argue that modern feminism has gone too far and greater attention should be placed on men's rights.
I honestly think that when women are paid equally and that when we have no restrictions, legal restrictions on our own bodies, then we can have that conversation.
The other thing I'd like everyone to be aware is men have their own national day.
Right.
It's November 19th.
I was just
going to
say that. Yeah.
Can I just say something? Isn't feminism equal for everybody, though?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The question is feminism equal for everyone?
I think what we have to have here is a historical context, right? Women got the right to vote in 1919, not even 100 years ago. You know, we were disenfranchised. In some states, we were considered property. You know, this is a legacy that we have, and that's just as white women. If we consider the experience of minorities and the, you know, across the board experience of women in this country, you know, one of the things that we experience is being, sexually harassed in the workplace. You know, I bet every single woman here has been to a bar and been grabbed. And any time I bring this up to a man, they've never experienced that. These violations that we face just because we're women and people feel that there's a ability to touch our bodies. It's difficult to communicate that in a way that says, you know, we cannot have this conversation until some stranger doesn't feel like they can grab me.
I think there was a, on the very beginning slide, there's a picture from the suffrage movement from 1917, and all I kept thinking about is, oh my God, 100 years later, we're still fighting for basic human rights. This is the thing, all our rights are human rights. It's not men, it's not women, it's human rights. But why women, we're still fighting, is just, that's my head scratcher right there.
I agree. One of the signs that I've seen, I put a copy of it on the Boston March, and I saw it in these ladies' slides as well, is my arms are tired from holding this poster since 1960. And
even longer.
I often have, as I was preparing for today, and you may have heard it in the opening comments, my mind went to this place that said, have we gained any ground? We have. We certainly have. There's no doubt we have. I'm not property anymore. I have an education. I have a job. My husband sometimes says, how am I going to manage the household and children when cooking? I'm a very lucky person. But has that freedom, have those rights traversed all women across the world?
No.
That's dangerous. I watch Victoria. The comment is, the queen is only as strong as her king. I disagree.
I love that show.
Hello, I am Denise Mawade, and I am involved with the media here at BCC. So I am the interim chief of the BCC Observer. I do support, not just because I'm a woman, but like we said, because women's rights are human rights, and I have heard the other side of the coin, like you said, a queen is as powerful as a king. Well, not everybody is meant to have a family, so not everybody's going to be relying on a king to make it through life. The same way a guy doesn't have to marry you. I mean, that's the beauty of freedom of choice, freedom of life, and whatnot. But then again, women fight, for example, for paid maternity leave. And at the same time, we're not only fighting for women to have the right to enjoy the beauty of parenthood, but also for men to have that right. Because the first months of a child, the first years of a child, the more nurture they get from their parents, from their loved ones, the better suited that human being is going to be to be a productive citizen of the world. And that's where sometimes the barriers are. It's not women against men. It is getting educated that we are in a free society, quote unquote free society, but there are still so many items that we are not equal. There are fact-based information, data, where women are not making the same amount of money, regardless of the same type of skills and education that they may have as their male counterparts. So that's the kind of inequality that we are fighting for as human beings.
Fortunate to live in several countries overseas. I was in Brazil, Rio de Janeiro,
Portugal, where I lived for 8 years. I was in Johannesburg, South Africa. I was in England, London. I was in Paris. All majority of those countries, or few of them, are very developed nations around the world. And they use a very specific healthcare system that doesn't exclude no one, regardless of your gender, race, how much money you make. Still work very effectively. If you look at the countries like Germany, like Australia, like Finland, France, they are capitalist countries like the United States of America. And the population, even if you are foreign, living in those countries, so if you go there and you happen to be sick, they take your life as the first priority without looking at if you have money or not, regardless of money. And I just don't understand when the research says something positive, which has a positive impact towards human life, you continue to be so silly, so arrogant. I mean, it's crazy. And there is this history, not actually history, it's a fact actually, happened 3 or 4 years ago regarding Michael Moore. Michael Moore, I mean, if you go to search on Google, you will see this particular story, which I felt very shocked when I was reading it. There was this particular woman living in Florida, and she has a pre-existing condition. She was very ill. She was on 60 or 65, ill 60s means 60s, no much more. And she was struggling because she didn't have money in order to treat herself. The pills that she had to take in order to relieve a little bit of pain she was having at that particular moment was like $100 for one pill. So the health insurance that she had couldn't cover at all. And the state could not do nothing in order to save this particular woman. Michael Moore, if I'm not being greedy, I'm just trying to say when something is right, gotta be done, gotta be, you know, we have to do it. Michael Moore picked his own money, took this woman, this lady, to Havana, Cuba. This lady was treated and got a solution for cancer that she had for so many years, more than 30 years, for free. I mean, this lady's American. She was born in Florida. My question is, what are you doing? I mean, what the heck? This is the United States.
We have the worst healthcare. We did.
It's
crazy.
ACA,
we were the worst country in the world.
That's what I'm saying. I just don't understand
it.
Get me out of it.
It's not even just healthcare. It's the worst prison system, the worst gun laws, the worst everything.
I mean, something is right, gotta be done.
Professor George, this is a whole semester question.
But maybe you speak to the larger issue is about, maybe we have to think about our ideology here, just even that it is framed that it's men versus women, rich versus poor, that we don't see it in terms of that we all benefit, and not to use another, you know, because of the rising tide lifts all boats, but this idea that unless we start thinking in terms of
Us collectively,
even with all our different, you know, groups or identities,
exactly. Yes.
we're not going to make any progress. Maybe that's where the work needs to be.
I agree completely with you, Professor Colleen. And I want to make the last statement. Actually, I saw that was actually from my there is this scholar from England that did research in order to understand how health insurance are perceived in the United States versus the rest of the world. And he ended up concluding that all over the world, health insurance, when you are sick, they take you as first priority. They life matter first. It's very important. We take life as business.
Oh, yeah.
That's the conclusion, and should be the other way around. I mean, if you're sick, regardless of how much money you have, you have to be clean. I mean, this is something you want. Talk about life.
It's all
about
business,
money.
Especially with this administration, with the repeals of, we have the EPA being repealed. You have animal, you have the list that documents all the puppy mills being repealed, because these are all businesses. Endangered Species Act, that's being repealed. Because again, you have companies, you know, I want to plow through this field. I don't care if there's an endangered little spotted turtle. How does that affect me?
To the fracking in Oklahoma that causes the earthquakes, but they pass laws so you can't sue them.
And
I mean, it's baffling.
Exactly.
It's all about the dollar.
And I think we are doing the right thing. This is the right cause, and I love
right.
The women's day. Today is beautiful. And it is something else to be.
I would say I grew up in a very conservative family, and
got, it didn't matter who we were or where we were, but Ireland was a fairly monocultural country, but it didn't matter who you were or what you owned. You got healthcare, you got what you needed. Now, I will say the other side of it is, if you have a disease process that is, it's a terminal type of illness, and you are of a certain age, the treatment does change a little bit. And so there are two sides to every sword, but I have to agree with you. All of the research suggests, and you guys are young, you guys should get out there and do something about this, all of the research suggests that if we treat humans as lives that matter, we'll have a much more productive society. Are there any other questions?
This is more of just a curiosity question. Maybe Emily can attest to this. So, just from being in a blue state and a red state, so do you feel like this creates a divide between women and women, like conservative women and liberal women? Because some women, I've come in contact with women who say that they are not a feminist. They don't believe in women's rights. Well, not believe in women's rights, but they don't believe in feminism. So then it makes me wonder, do they know what the definition is? Do you know what?
I think it's because it's all they know. My family's from the South. I'm the only liberal New England cousin. My whole family's from Texas and Southern California. So we try to avoid conversations like this because it is very, they can't wrap their heads around what I think, and I have a hard time wrapping my brain around.
There's a different culture too. When you move south or even southwest, there's a big increase in church culture, you know, and as church, as community. And so I think that some women are raised with the thought that feminism is a negative thing. So, you know, it doesn't mean that you can't have conversations about, you know, one-on-one conversations, which I think is the best way to have these kinds of conversations.
And it doesn't have to necessarily be red state, blue state. When I met my future father-in-law, my husband asked me not to use the F word in front of him. It was feminism because it was an age thing for him. I think what we need to do is a lot of education around what feminism actually is, because unless we define it, then other people can appropriate it and then again create the resistance to it. Hollywood starlets or, you know, I'm not a feminist.
Thank you. It looks like many of you need to move on. I want to thank you most sincerely for your
time.
Thank you for your time.
Group has left, but I want to thank most sincerely Colleen, Emily, and Susan for their work.
Thank you. This is what democracy looks like.
If you're wearing red and you want to be in a picture, come on down.
Yes.
May I please have the attendance?
If you want to be in the picture,